I'm going to try to go somewhat quick so we have time for questions at the end. But you're here for production tips and workflows with USD, Kinefx, and Solaris. But first, just a bit about Ingenuity. We're kind of new to the European market. We're just opening up our London office, so it's kind of not a name that's known so much around here. We have about 600 employees worldwide, kind of spread around the globe, offices in Los Angeles, Vancouver, Georgia, New York, Indonesia, and like I said, our newest office in London, which is hiring. We focus on kind of having small teams, kind of more of a small studio workflow, even though we are a kind of mid-sized place. We hire a lot of great people and really try to give our artists as much creative freedom to kind of put pixels on the screen as they can. We come from a music video background, so you know, started in 2004, coming up on kind of 20 years doing visual effects. And doing music videos, you're trying to make like 3 minutes of content in a lot of times like 2 or 3 weeks. So just we've always kind of had a lot of multi-shot workflows and kind of just a focus on automation and speed and kind of using the latest technology to make all of that happen. Currently, we work on episodic television, commercials, feature film, and still, you know, a handful of music videos. We do a lot of music videos for Taylor Swift. So if you've seen, we've done like 13 for her. So your odds are good that you've seen one of our videos. And we love Houdini. We've been on Houdini for probably 8 years now. I'm sure Chris knows the answer to that question. We use it for procedural modeling, layout, scattering, look dev, effects, CFX, and lighting. So pretty much everything after, everything but animation really kind of runs through Houdini for us. And it's been fantastic. If that's a decision that you're thinking about, if that's something that you're kind of looking into, can't recommend it enough. So I wanted to show our reel and kind of get a sense of some of the work that we've been doing with Houdini, which should have audio.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nothing's real. If you watch any television, it's all fake. So, think of questions. I'm hoping to have some time for those at the end. And to touch on, Chris kind of teed it up a little bit. We were pretty early adopters of USD and of Solaris at Ingenuity. We started off kind of right when the pandemic hit, kind of took that opportunity to really rework our pipeline and integrate a lot of those tools. And I want to kind of lightning round through some important USD stuff, but I think to preface all of that, it's really just our opinion and it's the way we work. The format is really flexible, and I think that's one of the things that's really so beneficial about it is that you can use it in a ton of different ways. So it's what works for Pixar and DreamWorks and some of the bigger places is kind of what a lot of the documentation is geared towards, and it can be really overwhelming, but you can also really simplify it down to kind of just its core and use it very effectively still as a kind of smaller studio like us. Don't overcomplicate things. This has been mentioned a number of times at a number of different USD talks, and it's really, really important. And for that, we start off with just kind of a simplified version of referencing layering. And that's predominantly to just throw away layers most of the time, just kind of frisbee them into the ocean. We only really use them for our tasks. So on the Houdini side, that looks like setting the USD ROP to just flatten all layers and preserve the references. This gives you a flattened stage, but you keep all your referenced assets and you get no layers, but you still have nice light files that you're sending to the farm. Because a reference in USD is just a file path, kind of similar to what linking would be in Blender or to what referencing would be in Maya. So that file doesn't actually live inside of your USD stage. And we find this is just really easy for artists to understand. Those are concepts that artists tend to be familiar with from other DCCs that they may have worked in the past. And then we have kind of the nuclear option, which is just flatten stage, collapse all references. This dropdown isn't really obvious when you first start using USD, but it's really critical to kind of control how you're interacting with the USD and what you're actually writing out to disk. So this will result in a huge file because it's everything that you've pulled into your scene all written out to that one USD, but it also is kind of like a get out of jail free card. Like if something's breaking or not working correctly or not working on the farm, just burn it down and collapse it all to one file and send it. Cause at the end of the day, it's just pixels on the screen that we care about. So that's kind of what we work towards. So then you're left with just this question of whether to reference or sublayer. Cause those are kind of the two methods that we really use to import stuff into USD. And pretty much everything is a reference. So our assets are like pre-caches. Like if you have a big node network in USD and you want to kind of cache that out and read it back in, that's a reference, et cetera. And then the only thing that we really use sublayering for is the actual task files. So a typical task layout might look like just bringing in each of those, tracking anim effects, et cetera, and then writing that out as your shot. And then on the shot work side, it's a really simple network of just a layer break so that everything above that layer break doesn't get saved out, and whatever shot work you are doing written out to your task file. Staying organized is really crucial on the USD side as well. We've been staying organized in Nuke for a lot longer, and we kind of take a lot of cues from that department in terms of like keeping a big kind of B pipe that everything is kind of coming into. This is, I can't show the end result of this because this is still a work in progress scene, but this was laid out actually by Ivan, who's here from our office, and was like a really nice, nice, well-organized scene graph and felt like a good one to kind of demo. Just big, tall B pipe of everything kind of merging in. And the important part here is that the stuff that you want to change the most is kind of last in that node graph. And it just makes for the editing kind of a lot quicker. And this is something they've improved in 19.5 in terms of like the cooking of those merge nodes, but still just having the lighting at the bottom of your scene will make a massive difference in terms of the speed of and kind of performance of Solaris. So then I want to go over kind of our use of USD and Kinefx on an American science fiction show called La Brea. For those of you who don't know La Brea, there's a giant sinkhole that opens up in LA, and it kind of is the worst day of their lives for the people for the rest of the show, I think, pretty much. So we have a little short reel of our work on that show. Cool. So the challenges for the spider, we had a lot of spiders. This is really very dark. We had a lot of spiders. You can't see much at all there, huh? That were very hero. And we needed to, that's probably the best slide. We needed to be able to have each spider have individual motion, but we're also very close to each of the spiders. So we needed it to be kind of the real full res spider the whole time. We couldn't use like a proxy spider for any of the shots. And I want to kind of do a quick demo on how we accomplished some of that stuff using Kinefx and Solaris. First of all, Kinefx really turned the page for Houdini on its relationship with FBX. Before, it was not the best, and now it's fantastic. You can pull FBX animation in straight from Maya and have a really good experience with that. And you know, this is kind of showing that. When you pull that animation in from Maya, it will try to load Maya's like default shader, and just the skeleton will be moving, not any of the geo. That's because it's missing a bone to form, which actually turns it into real moving spiders. So there's our spider in motion, and we just kind of trash off a lot of the attributes that are coming in from the Maya side to clear those materials out. And then another kind of gotcha is that the animation that comes in from Maya will still be scaled like 100 times too big. But luckily, fixing that on the Kinefx side is really easy. There's a kind of world space blending option on the skeleton blend node that will let us just take our good rest skeleton that has a nice scale and then kind of blend our kind of animation to be the correct size so we don't have a giant spider. We turn that into a motion clip, and then we use a configure motion clip node to set the name of that clip, which is just kind of used downstream. And the $OS symbol is in there to set that name. The skeletal world, the skeletal blend in world space is really amazing on the Houdini side. Like you have, you know, a rig anywhere and you can just blend it in world space without caring about, you know, the transforms or the parent hierarchy or anything like that. Just kind of treat it as, you know, as points that you want to blend as like a blend shape. And it gets you out of a lot of gotchas when we were working on the rigging side of things. And then also a pretty basic tip, but you see it a lot kind of in setups using $OS to stay organized, just helps you kind of auto comment your node graph. So you can really visually easily see like what this node is doing, what this node, this is walk angry, this is walk, you know, walk normal. So doing that is just kind of really a smart way to set things up and makes a lot of stuff easier going down the line. So back to demo, we make an agent from that rig, then we make really a very poly reduced version of our spider, and pop that in as an agent layer. So now we're into the agent system, which is Houdini's crowd system. And then we add that walking clip and set the clip time. And now we have a spider that walks. And then we can source those agents onto a number of points. We have a node that we use a lot called point transform. It's in pretty much every setup that I do that just does all of the kind of randomization, you know, random scale, random orient, stuff like that on the nodes. And then with that crowdsource connected, you now have a bunch of walking spiders that are kind of ready to go into a crowd sim. But that's not very interesting because all of the spiders are doing the same animation. So we want to make some variations on those. And to do that for the actual spot and for this demo, we used a full body IK inside of Houdini. Full body IK takes the rest skeleton and tries to kind of guide the bones in that rest skeleton to a set of target bones. So here I'm creating that set of target bones, which are just going to be the ends of our spider's feet and kind of his middle, his thorax probably. Our creature guy would know. I'm not up on my spider parts. So we're going to connect the rest skeleton to a full body IK and then point that second input to our target skeleton, which is just those handful of bones that we're trying to kind of reach to. And there's a couple of settings on the full body IK node that you need to kind of set first. So the idea that we're after is being able to move around the core of our spider to get different kind of poses. I connected that to the wrong input there. But the full body IK by default kind of doesn't have the right settings. So the mapping attribute is what it's looking for when you're doing kind of motion capture retargeting, because the idea is that you have a skeleton that you're targeting to that doesn't have the same bones. But here we're just using it to do variations. So we're just going to map by name instead because it's the same skeleton in both inputs. And then the damping on our full body IK was also set way too high. So we reduced that because we have, you know, a tiny little spider, not a giant one. So now we can drag around the spider's body kind of in real time and do variations of that walk really just by moving one bone around, which is just a really pleasant way to get that stuff done and, you know, way faster than going back to Anim and doing all of these different variations. And then we have, you know, our base that's still intact, and we have our new kind of more aggressive walk. So that's good, but I think, you know, looking at reference is something that I also harp on a lot. There's a Ian Hubert talk where he says, you don't have to look at reference for everything, just the stuff that you want to look good. And I think that's such a brilliant quote. I use it all the time. So if we look at real funnel web spiders, which is the spiders that we're trying to create, they raise their hands when they're trying to kill you, which I think is nice of them because you might see them more. So let's do that with Kinefx. So to accomplish that, we're going to duplicate that full body IK setup and then deselect those front legs so that they're kind of just stuck to their original animation. And then we can stick a rig pose node after we kind of adjust our body a little bit and pose those front legs kind of independent of our full body IK. And you know, when I do this, I'm trying to make our animators at home happy. So it takes me a second to kind of like get it just perfectly. But we're basically raising those legs up, and then we are, you know, saying that's our base state for our spider, and then we're gonna still run it through the full body IK to do that targeting. So now we have a spider with his raised legs. And I'm going to fix this left arm a little bit just because I'm kind of breaking the rig here. It's a little overextended. And then if I play this animation, he's now walking but holding his legs up. And it looks okay, but it kind of looks a little cheesy because his legs are quite stiff. So we can fix that with Kinefx as well. Using a skeleton blend node, we can just select those arm joints and blend on like a little bit of that walking animation. So just selecting those two front arms and then blending on like, you know, 20%, 30%, something like that of the walking animation. And now when we play that, his hands have like a nice little bit of kind of movement to them, but they're still up. So again, really quick alts, quick variations. You know, we're able to do five, six, 10 different animations for a spider in an hour instead of in a day. So that's really powerful. Then kind of to get all of these back into the crowd system, because we were smart and organized our stuff earlier, all we have to do is duplicate that motion clip setup, change the name of a couple of nodes to, you know, walk angry and walk arms or whatever. And then we can merge all those together and pull those into our agent clip setup. And now we have down at the bottom in our kind of spider agent, an agent that has three different animations, a walk angry, and a walk with his arms raised. So we need to instance those spiders in Solaris. And to do that, we borrow from gaming. I come from gaming. That's where I started off in the industry, and I switched to visual effects. And a lot of like games have a long development cycle and just have way more time to figure out problems. So they're a really great source of inspiration for the visual effects industry in terms of like how to solve stuff. And the inspiration for this came from a game called Super Mario 64, which is, I don't even know, like it's maybe too old for some of the people in here, which is kind of sad for me, to be honest. But if you look at Mario, his body isn't actually skinned. Like they're just hard pieces of geo that are parented to a skeleton. And it's actually that way for all of the characters in the game. Like they didn't have hardware skinning on the graphics cards, kind of figured out when they made this game. So, I mean, props to them from a design standpoint to just kind of get that done anyway. But how does this help us with our spiders? So if you remember our spiders, they're also kind of segmenty, and could maybe just be hard stuff parented to the bones. And that's exactly what we did, for the spiders in our scenes. So Kinefx is really just points with name and transform. And if you have any experience in Houdini, you know that that's pretty much all you need to do instancing. So to get that set up, there's all our spiders. And out of our crowd sim, we can just do an agent unpack and get back to the skeletons. So now we just have a bunch of Kinefx skeletons, which are really light, really easy to cache, really easy to iterate on. And they have those name and transform attributes that we need to do the instancing. And then our point transform has kind of a mode where we can extract that transform intrinsic and turn it into orient and scale, which is what Solaris wants as an attribute. And the code for that I've pulled out here just so it's not in like a black box node. It's super simple. It's just two lines. Taking the transform and converting it to a quaternion and then cracking it to get the scale. And then we just clean a bunch of attributes off of it. We have a node called attribute keep, which is like the opposite of attribute delete, just kind of keeps only the good stuff and trashes everything else. And it's, I think, better to have like an allow list as opposed to a deny list on the attributes, because it keeps you from adding a bunch of stuff up the tree and forgetting to add it into your attribute delete. And a clean minimal attributes is really the key to a happy Houdini. So many times I go into someone's scene and fix a bug just by trashing off like the 50 attributes that they've just kind of kept around in their geo. So you can middle click on the node and see all the attributes, and if it's more than like six, you're probably not doing it right. So to get our spider, we pull in a limbic spider because that's how the spider with its segmented was cached out. And we didn't have kind of correspondence to, we're doing the selection of this spider with paths. This is an important thing and something that's like not a really obvious thing in Houdini, but you can, in that dropdown, pick a limbic paths. You can also resize this window. I've used Houdini for way too long before I realized that that little window was resizable. The reason you use path-based selection in like kind of a professional environment is because upstream people aren't always like, maybe they're, you know, the publish is including, you know, some hair or a proxy or something like that, and it messes up your selection and then everything breaks. So just it helps keep your setups way more reliable and makes them kind of the output of them much more consistent. So to do our kind of spider rigging trick, we need to build correspondence between our segmented spider and the bones that we have. And to do that, we're going to use joint capture by Harmonic. They improved this node, I think, in 19. Before, it was like a bit of a hoop jumping situation to kind of get this to work. And now it's just one node, which is awesome. It basically turns your spider into like a tetrahedral mesh and then traces through the tets out to the skin from the bones to figure out what the weighting should be. So you get really good weighting, and it kind of works really reliably on pretty crazy meshes. So that's that node in action, kind of setting the bone weights for each of those spider segments. And then we do a bit of VEX to unpack those bone weights and kind of figure out which bone name they should actually be weighted to. So, you know, getting the most weighted bone for each of those points. And then that's kind of referencing the bone names that are over there in the second input. And then we're promoting those weights using our connectivity attributes, so using piece, which we set up the tree. That way we have the same weight for each of the kind of segments of the spider. The piece attribute or the on attribute promote is just a great way like to get attributes up out to each piece of geo. You can use a for each for this, but there's a penalty from a speed standpoint to doing that, and it's just much faster to use that on attribute promote. So doing that, and then we make a quick mask, just like a vertical mask that we'll use later to do like a bit of fur on the spider. And then another bit of VEX to kind of untransform those pieces. So we're getting the original bone transform and inverting that, and then inverting the position as well. And that ends up with just a bunch of spider parts kind of parked at the origin, all facing the same direction, ready to be instanced back onto the skeleton. That's a bit hard to explain visually, so I thought it'd be better to untransform these emojis instead. So each of these emojis, you can imagine, has a point and a transform. When we invert that transform, we're just setting them back to their original orientation. And then when we invert their position, we're just kind of parking them back at the origin. And then on the Kinefx side, we have an input that has transforms and names, and we can combine both of those two to get back to our kind of transformed emojis with a copy to points using the piece attribute of name. And then we're kind of back to where we started, but with a nice segmented spider. So walking through that same setup, hopefully a little more understandable. I do a quick groom on this just to visually show that the spiders can be a full, complex, realized, nice spider. Just using that same position mask that we made up in the tree to kind of set the hair length there, and then the copy pieces by name gets us back to our full spider. And if I plug, and that's the rest skeleton kind of coming in that has the names and the transforms from the Kinefx side. And if I plug the animation in here, we have a full spider that's walking around in the scene, but still walking around at 24 FPS because it's not it's not deforming anything. It's all just a bunch of pieces that are kind of copied to this to the Kinefx skeleton. You do get a little bit of erroring in the joints, but you have to be really, really zoomed in on these spiders to notice it. And with them all crawling around in the shots, it never really came up. So this was totally workable for us as a solve for how the spiders were going to play in the shots. So now we get to kind of pull all of this stuff into Solaris and set that up. To do that, we kind of clean up our spider parts and our spider hair. We import those separately because we can't have normals on the hair, because RenderMan will want to render those as ribbons if they have normals, which is not what we want. We want it to render as hair. So we import both of those on the Solaris side separately and then merge them together. So we have our spider parts again, just kind of parked at the origin, ready for instancing. And we set the hair to be just a proxy. Or just visible on render, not on proxy. Good proxies is really the key to having kind of nice, happy performance on the Solaris side of things. There's a ton of stuff that we don't want to see in our viewport, but we still want rendered. And it's super simple to just set that up on the Solaris side of things. And then the instancer has just our Kinefx skeletons pulled into it. And that gets you back out to kind of a full crowd of spiders with just the parts as the prototypes. And we could add, you know, 1,000 spiders in here, 10,000 spiders in here, and it would still be very performant and render very quickly. You know, so popping into XBU and just kind of looking at those spiders, we can see that they have, you know, full detail and hair and whatever else, and, you know, are very fast and again, very performant on the Houdini side of things. So proceduralism in Solaris. I think one of the nicest parts about Solaris is that you can edit USDs up from upstream and in a kind of non-destructive way. One of our favorite things to do is edit existing scale routes. This is something that we've kind of just recently started to explore and are now kind of in this mindset of like, well, what can we rig? Because anything that you can rig, you can basically pose around and work with in the scene. So we have a tree that's kind of boxy from one side and kind of nice from the other. And it's a rigged tree. It's a skeleton root, which is essentially just a skinned mesh that we've imported on the Houdini side. And we can, through a node that we have called RigPose, kind of dive inside and edit that rig. So this is creating a agent again from this tree. It's important to note that when we're importing this stuff, it's always going to import the proxy, which our proxies for our trees are really low because we tend to place a lot of them in the scenes. So we're just setting the render mesh to the proxy and the proxy to a guide up there before we import it. Probably, you know, we'll put a request in to have a purpose drop down on the import node, but you know, I'll work that out with the Houdini guys later. And then we can pop down a rig pose and pose the limbs of this tree to kind of fix our, you know, tree is too boxy from one angle note. And I wanted to kind of do this in the viewport live. I didn't run a Betty Crocker this because I think it's really important to show just how easy it is to kind of really art direct each of the limbs of this tree. And then we create an agent from our base rig. We create a motion clip from that kind of adjusted tree, and we pull that in a really similar way to what we did on the spiders. And then on the import side, all we need to do is import our skeletal root. We don't actually need the whole tree and the mesh and stuff like that, so the import process stays really quick. And we also trash off the skeleton. They actually fixed that in 19.5, so you don't have to trash the skeleton anymore to get the merge to work, which is awesome. Houdini fixing stuff. And now we have, if I toggle back and forth between these, a tree that's kind of reposed, but procedurally, and still kind of has all of its same shaders and same, you know, look dev and everything intact from an upstream department. So it's really nice way to, again, you know, I could duplicate this out and make six like variations of this tree very lightly in my scene without ever touching the original asset, and also without like republishing six different assets or going back to SpeedTree to make those variations. So yeah, really, really great stuff. You can also edit multiple materials inside of Solaris really easily. If you expand the scene graph tree on the bottom, it's really just kind of a geometry spreadsheet that you can actually edit. So if I expand this, we see that we have a bunch of different leaf materials that are assigned to this tree, which is pretty typical of a tree that's kind of coming from SpeedTree. If I put this drop down, there's a material column that you can show that will show which materials are assigned to the leaves. So you can see here the leaves have a ton of different materials. I'll expand one of them. We have for each of our shaders on the leaves kind of a standard hue correct. And if I right click on that property, you can hit edit property and it'll just pop down an edit property node, and then you can change those values. And you can do this with anything inside of Solaris. So it's one of those things that's not very obvious in the UI, but is really powerful if you like have an asset from upstream and you just need to tweak the, you know, the diffuse gain to be a bit darker or something like that. And here I'm just using wildcards to set the path on the assets that I want to, on the primitives that I want to edit, to be essentially all of the leaf materials. So I'm setting that albedo kind of hue correct on all of the leaves. And then just to kind of prove that it's working, set it to gray, which is probably not what we want. We probably want to be, you know, somewhere in the 75 to 80% range for realism. But I think the more important thing to note is that you could do this note on, you know, these two trees in the corner feel a little too green, or all of the trees need to be fall, that sort of thing. It just makes notes like that really straightforward to accomplish. And then kind of a handful of bonus round tips. The drone camera in Houdini is I don't know, I think they added an 18, is a super great addition. If you hit escape on the camera or in the viewport, you'll go into like the camera mode. And then this little icon, which I think could be better personally, will turn it into a drone. And you can use like WASDA and viewport mouse to kind of fly around as if you were in Unreal. We find ourselves building a lot of very large Houdini scenes in Solaris these days. And I use this a ton to navigate those scenes just because it's such a more kind of pleasing environment. The mouse scroll kind of makes the speed faster and slower. Control Alt S in 19.5 is the new hot key for Zen mode. It used to be toggle stow bars if you hit the tab menu. And it just takes all the UI of Houdini kind of away, all of the little extra like buttons and widgets and gizmos on the side of the viewport, and kind of makes it a bit more of like an artistic experience. All oftentimes when I'm working in SOPs to do like procedural, you know, geometry and modeling and stuff, just kind of make one big node graph editor, hit P to pop open the parameters pane, and then just toggle kind of Zen mode and just have like such an aesthetic Houdini experience that feels really nice and, you know, kind of, I think, marginally improves my creativity, but, you know, your results may vary. And then the last one is to learn programming. I know this is an easy thing to just pop on a slide, but really there are more computers than there are people in the world. All of those computers speak code. So just some really good resources to kind of look at that stuff and kind of do training, because I think it is really important and really does make your efficiency in Houdini much better. So with that, we are hiring. We're always looking for great people across all of our offices. Our website's there. Go apply. And thank you all for coming. How'd we do? We have time for questions.
We do. Yes.
We've done it. We have time for questions.
Love it. That was the goal.
Who's got some? Remember, he asked you to think about your questions in advance.
I feel like I could have used that tip so many, like all the talks yesterday are like questions. I have no idea.
This presentation, I love it to hear. One question, you showed about like how to use Kinefx on a spider. So how often do you find yourself using this for like a character itself that needs like deformations and it's not like a hard kind of like rig around?
Yeah, it's interesting. We used it on the spider, and then now it's just the way we do all of our insects. So we used it on the wasps that were like immediately following because they're also insects and they're segmented. We're using it on ants for a job, for two different jobs currently. So it's a really nice kind of workflow for that. We do find that on the like kind of more CFX like creature pipeline, we're starting to use it more because it keeps the bones like rigidly parented to the skeleton and is much more performant and comes with a lot more data than doing like an alembic export of that and kind of having to recreate it. So I would say our pipeline is moving towards using like Kinefx and FBXs as a primary way of getting kind of stuff over from Maya. There's some stuff that's lost in translation, like the, you know, the delta mushing on the Maya side and a lot of the stuff like that, but the blend shapes still come across, and we're, I think, kind of moving towards getting more of our rigging stuff done on the Houdini side anyway. So we're kind of okay to lose some of that stuff and then just kind of recreate it on the Houdini side once we do, you know, muscle sim and tissue and stuff like that.
That's good to know. Thank you.
Oh, can you pass that to Jeff?
So I'll get the. Yeah. So I guess the question was, how do you use a deforming spider, right? The answer is you can use biharmonic capture and then turn it into a crowd agent, and everything's there. So that's pretty straightforward. Yeah, there you go.
On spot tech consultant.
Any other questions? USD questions, Kinefx questions. Over here.
Hi, thank you very much for the presentation. How would you animate a snake movement within this framework?
Within this framework?
Yeah.
Or yeah,
is
so
it possible?
I think one of the most important parts of Kinefx is like if you have a line, you have a rig. So you can create a line for that snake with as many or as few segments as you want, and then rig doctor to initialize the bone transforms, and then you can just path transform or path deform that line, and it will kind of deform the rig in kind, and then you just skin the snake to those bones with biharmonic capture, and you know, off to the races you go. So it's really great for specifically like path, you know, kind of path based stuff like that, because you can then just do kind of anything you can do in SOPs to the line, to the actual Kinefx skeleton, you can do on the rig, and it'll kind of come along for the ride.
Great. Any other questions? Yes.
I'm just wondering about, for example, the trees that you showed.
Yeah.
Like, would it be, or are you using it? Like, for one example, for example, where you have a lot of trees and you need some wind, and you have a lot of different trees, and sometimes you just need to bake that out as a yield, which is really heavy and time consuming. Like, is it possible to use this as a...
Absolutely.
Because, for example, like Arnold doesn't like having lots of instances, for example. It's like it's forever to start rendering. And in this case, like, do you think this is a viable solution?
Yeah. So I know that they're kind of working on getting the support for skeletal roots to be kind of even greater. You currently can't put them into a point instancer, but if you have like hundreds of trees, you can have them as regular instances with individual wind timings, and it's still really quick. So we actually have support because the trees are just skeletal roots. We have support for the trees in our crowd system, and then we have a node called skeletal wind that will just add kind of blowing wind to the trees. And you can plug the trees into the crowd, plug that animation in, and you get kind of a forest of blowing trees. You also then get, we're doing a shot for a show right now where the trees need to be stationary, and then they get blown by a shockwave, so they have a bunch of really strong wind. And you know, doing that with the crowd system is really easy. You can just have a kind of radial trigger that triggers a secondary animation. Whereas if you were kind of doing that in a traditional workflow with like SOPs, you'd have to carry around a lot more data to make that a reality. So it's actually like scrubbable in the viewport to see that wind interaction on the trees, which is really great. So we're moving towards, like I said, having basically everyone's kind of mentality right now is just like, what can't we rig? You know, like, can we rig the little grass? Can we rig? So there's very much a push to kind of have a lot of stuff out in the world using this system, you know, closed lines and stuff like that, because the animation is so light. It's just like a skeleton, and all the instance geo is still, you know, still instance. So
thank you for the good solution.
Of course.
We have time for one more if anyone has one. And if not, then we'll say thank you, Grant.
Very welcome.